I pray you all came in expectation. It is so good to see you all this morning. This is a very special morning. This is a morning where millions of people around the world celebrate as the resurrection of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the church said, guys, y'all got to do better than that. There is no sense in celebrating the resurrection of Christ if you don't know how to praise Christ. I said that this is the morning of the resurrection of your Lord and your Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Some of y'all sitting there like, oh, praise God, oh, Jesus. No, you don't know what happened, but I'm going to break it down this morning so it can bless you, so that next year you're going to be ready. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, you have some people that will speculate with you and deliberate with you as to when did Jesus really rise up, whether he rose up on a Saturday, whether he rose on a Sunday. And I would like to submit to you that when he got up, it's not even a heaven or hell issue, considering that he did get up. And the church said, whether he got up on a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, it don't even matter when he got up. All that matters is that he got up. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Sometimes we can hang on stuff that we don't have no business hanging on. Amen. Dear God. But I believe that the most important thing about the advent that took place over 2,000 years ago, the resurrection of Christ, is how does what he did benefit me in my everyday life? How does it benefit me in 2016? Amen. Because that was over 2,000 years ago. I know what he did over 2,000 years ago, but how does what he did benefit me in 2016? Because if you cannot tie the two together, please understand me, you will never ever be anchored, you will never be settled in the finished works of Christ, and you will always be engaged in self-effort. And when you're engaged in self-effort, it voids out everything that he died for. And the church said, you see, he died for a reason, glory to God. And you have to know exactly what that reason is so that you can begin to live the resurrected life. And the church said, so this morning I want to teach on a message that is entitled, he died so we can live. And the church said, he didn't just die for no reason at all. He wasn't raised for no reason at all. When he got up, glory to God, guess what? You got up. I said, when he got up, you got up. Amen. Let me do that. When he got up from the dead, that means you too got up from the dead. Glory to God. What does that mean? You should not have any dead situations in your life. If your marriage is dead, if your relationship is dead, if your money is dead, if anything in your life is dead, when he got up, you too got up. There should be nothing dead in your life because you've been raised to life. Glory to God. And everything that pertains to you is alive. Glory to God. Somebody say, I'm alive, glory to God. Hallelujah. The resurrection of Christ is a celebratory moment, glory to God. It's something for us to celebrate for the rest of our lives, glory to God. Because he got up. When he got up, dear God, I got up with him. And the church said, you know, some time ago I had the privilege of accessing a revelation about the doctrine of Christ. And the doctrine, you notice in the Word of God, Paul has a lot to say about the doctrine. Amen. And the reason why that is because we're living in a season right now to where there's many doctrines that's coming forth. And people want to confuse you with different doctrines. In the Word of God, he says that the doctrine of Christ is the doctrine that you really need to be focused on, because the doctrine of Christ is the by Christ, in Christ, and through Christ doctrine. And what that simply means is, if you don't understand what was done by Christ, then you won't understand that you are in Christ. And if you don't understand that you are in Christ, you don't know what you can do through Christ. And the church said, the by Christ, in Christ, through Christ doctrine, please understand me, is the same thing as the gospel of grace. Amen. The unmerited, the unearned, and undeserved favor of God. And please understand me, he says, whether or not you benefit from the resurrection has everything to do with your crystal clear understanding of the doctrine of Christ. And the church said, so this morning I want to build a foundation. I want you to turn with me, if you will, to the book of Romans chapter 6. And I'm going to read that out of the Amplified Bible. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God is a good God. Amen. And I want you to listen intently, because this message might not make you hoop and holler and running around the church. But I guarantee you it's going to stimulate your understanding, because when you leave here, you're going to know how to benefit from the resurrection. And the church said, amen. Amen. We believe in teaching the word of God with precision and with, oh, thank you for playing. We believe in teaching the word of God with precision and with, come on now. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. We're just living in that season where you got to get understanding. Amen. All right. In the book of Romans chapter 4, Romans chapter 6, verse 4. And I'm going to read that out of the Amplified. It reads this way. Matter of fact, we got it on the screen. Let's everybody read that out loud. Ready? Read. We were buried therefore with him by the baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, so we too might habitually live and behave in the newness of life. Now stop right there. I just want you to stop right there just for a second, and then I'll read it on a little later. But I want you to zero in to something. He says, so that you can habitually live. In other words, you have to get to the point to where now you have established a habit in the Word of God in order for you to benefit from the resurrection of Christ. If your prayer time is not habitual, if your fellowship time is not habitual, if spending time in the Word of God is not habitual, then we will not benefit from the resurrection of Christ the way that he's always intended for us to benefit from the resurrection of Christ. He said it has to become habitual to you in order for you to really benefit. And the church said, he says, we were buried with him, therefore, with him by the baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, so we too habitually live and behave in the newness of life. In order for us to experience the benefits of the newness of life, we got to develop a habit of walking in our new nature. And the church said, if verse 5, it reads like this, for if we have become one with him by sharing a death like his, we shall also be one with him in sharing his resurrection by a new life lived for Christ. And the church said, you see, sometimes we have a tendency to want to do our own thing and live our own life the way we want to live our own life. That's no less than selfism. Amen. Do you know that you have never been created to live unto yourself? I'm going to say that one more time. We were never created to live unto ourselves as human beings. Matter of fact, if you really focus all the way back, human beings have always been somebody's property. And the church said, we first were created by God. And then when Adam committed high treason in the Garden of Eden, we then belonged to the. And then when Jesus redeemed mankind from the curse of the law, we belonged back to. But one thing that we can all agree on is that you ain't never belonged to yo. You better say that. You better say that. I'm just saying. Amen. But sometimes we go through this life wanting to live the life that we want to live, do our own thing, not realizing that's not why we were created. And the church said, let's move on, amen. In verse 6, we know that our old, unrenewed self was nailed to the cross with him in order that our body, which is the instrument of sin, might be made ineffective and inactive for evil, that we might no longer be slaves to sin. For when a man dies, he is freed, he is loosed, and delivered from the power of sin among men. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Christ. Amen. Because we know that Christ, the anointed one, being once raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has power over him. Verse 10, watch this. For by the death he died to sin, ending his relation to it once for all, and the life that he lives, he is living to God in unbroken fellowship with him. Even so, verse 11, consider yourselves also dead. Now check this out. Because you partook of the resurrection with Christ, and you died with Christ, you raised with Christ. You died with Christ. You were raised with Christ. Amen. In other words, if he got up, you too got up, and you got to know beyond a shadow of a doubt, now that I've been raised with Christ, now I'm supposed to live on to Christ. I'm not supposed to live on to myself. I'm not supposed to live on to anybody else, but I'm supposed to live on to Christ because he's the one that raised me up, glory to God. And the church said, he says, even so, consider yourselves also dead to sin, and your relation to it is broken, but alive unto God, living in unbroken fellowship with him in Christ. Did y'all hear that? Did y'all hear that? He says, because of what took place, because he factored you in, he says, just like he got up, you too got up. And because you got up, now you've got to give credit to the one who got you up. You got to start loving Christ. You got to start serving Christ. You got to get serious about the gospel. You got to spend quality time in the Word of God. You got to spend quality time in prayer. You got to check this out. I love the way he broke it down. He said, unbroken fellowship with God. Glory to God. To where you're always basking in his presence. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you some of the problems and some of the issues that we can experience in life. We can eliminate a whole bunch of that stuff if we are in unbroken fellowship with God. The resurrection is about you getting back where it is that you were before in an unbroken fellowship with God. And the church said, we got to yearn for it. We got to desire it. We got to long for that. Because everything is with God. He said, with God, all things are possible. Somebody say all things. He said, with God, all things are possible. He said, those many problems that we face from one day to another day, he said, it's possible. He said, those things that look impossible to you, he said, it's possible. He said, the healing that the doctor said was incurable, he said, it's possible. Because you're in unbroken fellowship with God. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? Saints, we got to be sold out about the resurrection. It's one thing to celebrate the resurrection of Christ, but you got to have a crystal clear understanding that he died in order for you to live. And the church said, and the church said, and the church said, hallelujah. Now, I don't mean to be up here hollering, but you know, I'm excited about the Lord. Hallelujah. You see, I know what he did for me. I know he changed my life. Glory to God. I know he redeemed me from the curse of the law. I know he gave me eternal life. And I'm settled in it. I'm rooted in it. I'm grounded in it. Glory to God. I will never be moved. Hallelujah. I'll never be moved. Are you listening to me? Nobody or no thing will ever be able to bait me out of my position of rest with Christ. Glory to God. Saints, we got to be that sold out. Yes, we do. Somebody in my will, they don't take all that. Oh, you just don't know. You got to be sold out, because if you're not sold out, when those many winds of doctrine come blowing your way, then you will be bamboozled by the many winds of doctrine that come blowing your way, because you're not settled in the doctrine. The doctrine of Christ, glory to God. The by Christ, the in Christ, and through Christ doctrine, hallelujah. The resurrection is one thing. You know about the cat of nine tails and that he got a crown of thorns on his head. It's one thing to hear the Easter story. How many of y'all have already heard the Easter story by the showing of hands? That's la-di-da-di, everybody. Some people have, some people haven't. But this morning, I'm here to tell you, I'm going to show you why he died, and I'm going to show you the benefits of his resurrection. And the church said, you're going to leave here with some understanding. And the church said, and the church said, glory to God. Once you come to the realization that your old man has passed away and your old man has died with him, once you come to the realization that when he was resurrected, you also were resurrected, please understand me, your life will change. Everybody looking for change, you need to come to a realization before you see the manifestation of change. Amen. In other words, watch this. You got to change your posture in order to change your position. I say, you got to change your posture in order to change your position. And if you don't change your posture, you will never, ever change your position. And the church say it. Amen. In other words, you got to settle it right here. Because once you settle it right here, then everything else will begin to flow in your life like it's supposed to flow. Dear God, he has laid it out for us, glory to God. Everything you need, everything you want, everything you desire is encapsulated by the grace of God. Hallelujah. The resurrection gave birth to the grace of God. To where there's nothing missing, there's nothing broken. You have everything you need, everything that you want. There is no lack for any good or beneficial thing, glory to God. Whatever it is that you desire, he says, I already factored it in. He said, and you will never ever, watch this, see any trouble in your life that I have not already factored it in, glory to God. I factored it into the grace of God. So when you go through what you go through, don't think in your mind that I have not already seen it or considered it or factored it in. I've already factored in the solution, but you got to access my grace. In order to access my grace, you got to stop engaging in self-effort. And the church said, because once we stop engaging in self-effort, the grace of God will begin to work. And the church said, and the church said, are you all excited this morning? Hallelujah! You know, some people say, I don't need a microphone. You know, I'm a Texan, man. I'm just loud, glory to God. Are you listening to me? That's what Christ does for me. You see, I know where I came from, glory to God. You all have no idea. And I'm here to tell you, if he can change me, then la-di-da-di, everybody can be changed by the gospel. Hallelujah. And the church said, God is a good God. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. Amen. He said, lo, I will be with you always. Amen. And 1 Peter, real quick, watch this. 1 Peter chapter 1. Verse 23 in the Message translation, Kalina. Thank you so much. See, I like the way that the Message translation breaks things down, so I want you to really get a hold of this. Somebody say amen. Reckon I better take these off now. Praise God. Watch this. He says, your new life is not like your old life. Your old birth came from a mortal sperm. Your new birth comes from God's living word. Amen. Just think, a life conceived by God himself. Verse 24. That's why the prophet said, the old life is a grass of life. Its beauty is short-lived as wildflowers, and grass dries up and the flowers droop. In verse 25, God's word goes on forever. Did y'all see that? He said, beyond a shadow of a doubt, and I'm trying to convince you of something. I'm trying to convince you that the old you died with Christ. Get that. The old me, the old you, the old you died over 2,000 years ago with Christ. And the new you rose up a long time ago. Amen. He said, now that you were raised in a new life, he said that you are now a new creature in Christ. You're a new species of being that never existed before. And the church said, go with me, if you will, to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. And I'm going to read that out of the Amplified. You're a new creature of being. You're a new being. And you are a spirit that possesses a soul that lives inside of a human natural body. You are not the body, but you are on the inside of your body. You are a spirit that possesses a soul that lives inside of a human natural body. For a long time, we have seen the body as the person when the person's in the body. Are you listening to me? What does that mean? He's trying to communicate very clearly to us that you are an immortal being. Because you are in Christ, you now have the benefits of the resurrection to experience eternal life instead of eternal death. He said that now that I live and I will never ever die again, he said you too shall live and you will never ever die again. Somebody shout hallelujah, glory to God. And we can have the same confession, glory to God. Death, where is your sting, glory to God? Because we have been blessed with eternal life. You know, you see, in the natural, you know, your body won't live forever in the natural. But you got to understand, as a new creature in Christ, if Christ lives forever, then every member of his body will too live forever. And the church said. And the church said, we're new creatures in Christ. Amen. All right, all right, all right. 2 Corinthians real quick. Hallelujah. Y'all just got me up here talking, Lord have mercy. Verse 14. Watch this. Verse. I'm going to read it out of the Amplified. For the love of Christ controls and urges and impels us, because we are of the opinion and conviction that if one died for all, then all died. And you got to get that. Because if you don't realize that you have died, your old man has really died already, then you will not live in your new nature. Matter of fact, you'll have a tendency to try to resurrect the dead with old memories. But that's all I'm going to say about that. Amen. He said, for the love of Christ controls and urges and impels us, because we are of an opinion and the conviction that if one died for all, then we all die. Amen. And he died for all so that all those who live might live no longer to and for themselves, will no longer live to and for themselves, will no longer live to and for themselves. I just got stuck right there. But to and for him who died and was raised again for their sakes. Sometimes we wonder why we experience the turmoil in our lives that we experience in our lives, not realizing that if your will is not in sync with his will, it causes turmoil. Every single time, amen. Turmoil will always exist where your will is not in sync with God's will. Don't deceive yourself into thinking that it will not. It will always cause turmoil and an adverse effect in your personal life if your will is not in sync with God's. And the church said, did y'all get that? All right. Verse 16, consequently, from now on, we estimate and regard no one from a purely human point of view in terms of natural standards and of values. No, even though we once did estimate Christ from a human viewpoint and as a man, yet now we have such knowledge of him that we know him no longer in terms of the flesh. In other words, now that you are born again, now that you have accepted Jesus in your heart as your Lord and personal Savior, he's clearly communicating, you're not just human. He says, you're not purely human. Even though it might look like on the outside that you're purely human, because you have been born of God, hallelujah, you've got the God gene on the inside of you. And when you got the God gene on the inside of you, that means that you have all power, you have all wisdom, you have all knowledge, you have all understanding, glory to God. That means that you can be healed from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. That means you can decree a thing and it will be established, glory to God. No weapon that is formed against you will ever prosper because you are a carrier of the God gene, glory to God. Somebody say, I have the God gene. I have the God gene. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Are you all getting this? We are not merely human beings any longer. We have received the sperma of God that cannot be tainted by sin, cannot be affected and gotten to by the devil. You are not purely human. You are, I like that, you are superhuman. But if you don't realize that you died with Christ, then you will not ever realize the benefits of the resurrection with Christ. You're not going to do it. And here's what it is. In the times that we're living in right now, before the culmination of time, before he returns, before he catches us up in the clouds and everything else, please understand me, he needs for every born-again believer to come to the realization and the revelation that they are new creatures in Christ, so that toward the end there can be great exploits that will win those souls out of the darkness into the marvelous light of God. And the church said, yeah, it's about the souls, amen. But if they can't see Christ in us, if they can't see how the resurrection benefited us, why in God's name are they going to forsake what they're doing in order to do what they're doing? Why are they going to forsake their way in order to follow your way if every time they see us, we act in the same way? I'm just saying. Are you listening to me? I'm just trying to help you. Amen. It's like we how in the world are you gonna be in the Word for 20 years and you ain't changed? I'm trying to be mindful. How is that possible? You've been reading the Word, you've been spending time in the Word, spending time in prayer, and you still act like a hellion. Really? No. Something wrong. Something's not quite matching up, amen. There's a blockage somewhere that's not allowing the Word of God to get on the inside of the heart, and it's not taking root. And because it's not taking root, it's not producing the fruit. And the church said, the Word is designed to change you so that you can get into that place that God has always intended for your life. Glory to God. But if we're not allowing the Word to get in because, you know, we're too intellectual, We got too much tradition going on, and we won't let the Word of God to bypass all that stuff, get on the inside of our heart, to change us from the inside out. And the church said, well, don't get quiet on me now. I'm trying to help you. Hallelujah. Now, I need to take you on a little detour. real quick, because you got some people who still speculate whether or not Jesus did rise from the dead. And I believe that I can prove to you, as in a court of law, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that Jesus did rise from the dead. Amen. And I want you to turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 27. I'm not going to read the whole thing with you because 27 goes into 28. But I'm going to start you here and then I'm going to tell you a little story and laugh a little bit. Amen. But I believe that I can produce enough evidence to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that he rose from the dead. Because if I can prove that he rose from the dead, it also proves that you did too. God Almighty, man, I think that that's one of the most powerful revelations in the Word of God. If I can prove that he rose from the dead, then that means that you did too. And now that I rose from the dead, dear God, I need to live the life that he's always intended for me to live. Because if I don't live the life that he intended for me to live, then I'm always going to run into turmoil. I'm always going to have problems. I'm always going to be going through some stuff. It's called the boomerang effect, amen? To where we reap what we sow, amen? And the church said, in the book of Matthew chapter 27, you know the Word of God says it very clearly. He said, you know, think it not strange when all these fiery trials come upon you. Think it not strange. Because if you trace it all the way back, it's probably coming from a seed that you have sown. And the church said, I know this isn't the traditional Easter message to where somebody hollering at you and hooping a little bit, but I guarantee you're going to get some understanding. And the church said, 27 verse 50, everybody there? All right. It reads like this. Jesus, when he cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain. That means it was ripped, it was split in two from the top to the bottom. And the earth did quake and the rocks did rent. And the graves were open, and many of the bodies of the saints which slept, I want you to zero in on that. The bodies which slept. You see, spirits don't sleep. We don't need no sleep. Bodies do sleep, but spirits do not sleep. And the church said, all right, I just wanted to show it to you. And came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly and saying, truly, this was the Son of God. And many women who were beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee, the children. And when the evening was come, there was a rich man named of Arimathea, named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. And he went to Pilate and begged for the body of Jesus so that he can wrap him up and put him in the tomb and everything else. But one thing that I want you to zero in on is, now when he says a centurion, I want you to get the implication of what he is saying. The significance behind that is that a centurion is the commander of a Roman army. He was an eyewitness to everything that took place. And he was brought to such a place of convincement to where he abandoned his five senses and began to believe that Jesus was exactly who he said that he was. And then they went back to the governor and all these different people, and they told him everything that they saw. And check this out. When he went back to the governor and everything else and told him everything that he saw and everything, the governor, they told them, I need for you all to make up a lie. You read it very all the way through. He said, matter of fact, he gave them some hush money, number one. He gave them some hush money and then made up a lie and said, okay, this is the story that I need for you to rumor. I need for you to tell everybody and spread the rumor that the disciples came in the night to steal the body when we were all, when y'all were sleeping. Did y'all hear that? Now, you know we don't condone any lying at all in this church. But if you gonna tell a lie, God dog be good at it. You gotta have to tell a good lie. You're gonna have to trace that thing all the way from A all the way to Z. So to make sure that the lie, it almost sounds true. The reason why I say that, because watch this. When you are a Roman soldier and you fall asleep on duty, that is a death sentence all in itself. But there was no death sentence carried out. Matter of fact, they were rewarded and they were paid some hush money. And the church said, watch this. Number two, they said, tell everybody that they stole the body. But they forgot to send out the Amber Alert. They forgot to send out the Amber Alert. There was no cold case file that was opened up about the body. They didn't search from door to door to door to door to look for the body that they said was stolen. So it made the lie look like it was a lie. Are you listening to what I'm saying? In other words, if they would have covered themselves, if they would have committed, if they would have executed those guys, if they would have sent out an Amber Alert, if they would have started an investigation about the missing body, you know, it might have been room for a little speculation whether or not he rose. But they did not send out no Amber Alert. They did not start a cold case file. Because they themselves were brought to the convincement that Jesus was who he said that he was, and he did rise from the grave. And the church said, check this out. If there was no investigation, that meant that the resurrection really happened. And everybody who doubted who Jesus was, they now believe that he was who he said that he was. Glory to God. How's that for evidence? Amen. You see, when you're reading the Word of God, you got to really look into that thing, because there are some things that will be exposed to you, glory to God. And if you pay close attention, that means that, dear God, he really did rise in every Roman soldier. In the book of Acts, it even says to where even now there were some chief priests who did decide to get saved. Why? Because they were brought to a place of convincement. They abandoned what they formerly believed, and they believed that Jesus was who he said that he was. How much for us who've accepted Jesus in our heart as our Lord and personal Savior? Now that we have accepted him in our heart as our Lord and personal Savior, we got to get to the point to where now we have an intimate relationship with him. And because of that intimate relationship that we have with him, it's like, dear God, how can I not serve him for the rest of my life? How can I not live my life unto him? Because my life is hidden within him, glory to God. He's the one that made my life possible. Listen to this. Before the resurrection of Christ, everybody in here was doomed to eternal death. Every single one of us. Amen. But now that we have accepted Jesus in our heart as our Lord and our personal Savior, glory to God, we have been blessed, glory to God, with eternal life. Hallelujah. We've been blessed with eternal life. Can you imagine dying forever and ever and ever and ever? All over again. My God, my God. But because of the resurrection of Christ, he says that we have eternal life. But check this out. It's important to understand. Eternal life doesn't begin when you get to heaven. I'm going to show it to you. Watch this. Ephesians chapter 1, real quick. Ephesians chapter 1. Somebody shout hallelujah. It doesn't start when you get to heaven. Is everybody with me?
Just say amen when you're there, verse 3. All right. It reads like this. Blessed be the God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, empowered us to prosper with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Glory to God. He said that everything that you need, you see, in other words, eternal life does not only begin when you get to heaven. He put what you needed on the inside to experience eternal life while you're here on the earth. And once we realize that we are in Christ, and we realize that everything that we do is through Christ, then we'll begin to see the manifestations of heaven on earth. Because now we know, check this out, a lot of people think when he says heavenly places isn't in here. Amen. Where? Let me ask you this, showing of hands, where is Christ right now? That's what I'm talking about. He is in you, he said, in heavenly places in Christ. So if Christ is in you, then so is heavenly places. And you've been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. You see, before any natural blessings come, you got to understand where the place is where you get the spiritual blessings. Spiritual blessings are within me. And because they're in me, dear God, I can call those things that be not as though they were. And they'll line up to what it is that I got to say. And the church said, hallelujah. Give God a shout in this place. Glory to God. Now, real quick, I need you to roll with me in the book of John chapter 10 real quick. John 10:10. God is so awesome. He loves you so much. He'll never stop loving you. Do you know for him to stop loving you is for him to stop loving his son? Listen to that. You got to hear that, because sometimes we can get caught up into different things, and the devil will try to solicit you with condemnation. He'll try to get you to feel guilty and shameful and everything else. Man, that's of the devil. That is not of God. Amen. But I'm going to say this too. There is a godly sorrow that you would feel because you're the righteousness of God. But he's not trying to condemn you. He's not trying to shame you. He's not doing any of that stuff. And it's important for us to realize that because you are the righteousness of God and because you're in Christ, he says that, you know, for me to stop loving you is for me to stop loving my son. He said, I've already called you to beloved. Remember that story where he said that when Jesus came up out of the water, he said, this is my beloved son whom I'm well pleased. Now, if he's the beloved son, I want you to know that you were represented in him when he said that this is my beloved son. Somebody say, I'm the beloved. Somebody say it with meaning. I am the beloved. Glory to God. You are the beloved of Christ. You are the beloved son of God. And guess what? There's nothing that God can do to stop loving you. Oh, I like that, Lord. I'll say that. You cannot sin your way out of God's love. You cannot sin your way out of God's love. Not condoning any sin whatsoever, but you cannot sin your way out of God's love. It's impossible. Amen. And the church said, y'all look like y'all got stuck on that. What? And the church said. All right. In John 10:10, it reads like this. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. In the Amplified, it reads like this. For the thief comes only in order to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. Glory to God. He said that's one of the purposes of the resurrection. He says, I want you to have life to the full until it overflows. Glory to God. Are you listening to me? He said, this is why I come. He said, I died so that you can live. But you won't experience the life that I intended if you don't understand what happened. When I got up, dear God, you got up too. So that means that you should never be down ever again, because I changed your posture deliberately. All we got to do is get in the Word of God and renew our mind to what He already is. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You change your posture and your position will follow suit. Change your posture and your position will follow suit. Amen. That's why the Word of God says it like this. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Why? Because He's the head, I'm the body. You know, I need to think exactly like He thinks. Matter of fact, check this out. I don't even need to use my own mind, because He's the head, I'm the body. And the church said, what does that mean? I need to get out of the habit of leaning to my own understanding, and the church said. Why? Because He the head, I'm the body. Amen. So I got to get to the Word of God and get into the Word of God and renew my mind to where now I let this mind be in me, which is also in Christ Jesus, to where I'm thinking like Him. And as long as I'm thinking like Him, I'm operating within the parameters of God's will, the good and the acceptable and perfect will of God. And the church said, all right, all right. Are y'all learning anything? All right, we're about to wrap this thing up. Amen. You know, there's so many scriptures that I could go to, but I'm not going to tie you up in that. Amen. Turn with me to the book of Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2, verse. Are y'all convinced that He rose from the dead? Did I present enough evidence to the court of law that Jesus did rise from the dead? And the church said. And the church said. If you believe that He rose, somebody give Him a shout, glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. All right. And the Amplified, it reads this way. I have been crucified with Christ. In Him, I have shared His crucifixion. It is no longer I who live, but Christ, the Messiah, lives in me. And the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in, by the adherence to, and the reliance on, and the complete trust in the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself up for me. Did y'all hear that? You got to hear what I'm trying to tell you this morning. Most of the turmoil and most of the challenges and most of the problems that we're experiencing in life, we are experiencing those things because we are not living unto Him. After all, He did save us. Amen. After all, we were all on death row. Check this out now. We were all of us were on death row, and then somebody called by God, stepped up to the plate and said, I'll do it for them. I'll suffer the penalty for the whole world. Wow. Really? I'm talking about for the whole world. Check this out. Not only for the whole world back then, but for those who were not even born yet. If the world gets up to 8 billion people, He said, I did this for 8 billion people. Amen. Everybody was on death row. He said, no, I see worth in them. I see value in them. You will never see value in yourself until you can understand the value of Christ. Once you understand the value of Christ, you will never devalue yourself ever again. You got to hear that. And it's coming up in my spirit, ladies, single ladies in here, don't continue to devalue yourself and accept any old Joe Blow into your life. who will have a nice, cute word for you and try to do a little bit of something for you. And no. Don't ever devalue yourself. You will never devalue yourself again once you understand the value of Christ. You'll never do it. Amen. And you got to be careful because it's around income tax time. Them jokers come a-creeping around income tax time. All of a sudden, they just want to all of a sudden be nice to you now. Really? I'm just keeping it real. Y'all don't mind. I'm going to keep it real with you. Around income tax time, they start to creeping. I'm just saying, man. Amen. You know what I'm talking about. Amen. All right, let me move on. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Turn with me, if you will, to the book of Colossians. Matter of fact, yeah, turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 28, in the Message translation. Mm-hmm. God is a good God, amen. You know what? Before you go to Colossians, turn with me to the book of John, chapter 14. John 14, 6, real quick. Mm-hmm. Watch this. In the regular King James Version, it reads this way. And Jesus says unto him, I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Did y'all hear that? He said, there's many who draw near unto me with their mouth, but their heart is far from me. He says that they call me the way, but they walk me not. They call me the truth, but they believe me not. They call me the life, but they live me not. He's saying, because I saved you, because I gave you my Holy Ghost, he said, will you be me while I'm gone? Will you be me while I'm gone? Will you be my body? Will you reach out and touch those who I ask you to reach out and touch? Will you minister to those people who you don't like? You know how we are sometimes. Will you minister to those people who don't necessarily look like you, smell like you, act like you? Will you be me while I'm gone? That's what it all boils down to. He's the head, we're the body. We get the instructions from the head, and all we got to do is follow suit. But yet, sometimes as born-again believers, we're too individualized. We on our own island. We don't want to love on nobody. We want to love those who it's easy to love. Guess what? Depending on how a person was raised, it's not easy to love everybody. It ain't. You know, we got some special folk in the body of Christ. We got some special family members. And the church said, yes, we do. But it's only the love of God that will allow you to supersede the limitations of your flesh and fulfill the perfect will of God every single time. Do you love? Will you love while I'm gone? Will you minister while I'm gone? Because everybody in here has been given the job of the ministry of reconciliation. Everybody has the ministry. That you say, well, I wonder what my calling is. The ministry of reconciliation. What does that mean? Well, let me break it down. Who have you reconciled lately? Wow. Did y'all hear that? And I know it was supposed to be upbeat and everything else. I'm so sorry, man. You know, I got to say what the Lord tell me to say, amen. He ain't calling me on no carpet. I'm here today. Last scripture. Let me go to the last scripture. Instead of Matthew chapter 11, go to Colossians chapter 3. Because I know y'all hungry. I hear some stomachs growling and everything else. Watch it. Hey, watch this. Watch it. In this area right here. Amen. Amen. Hey, you know what? Colossians 3, chapter 1 in the Message translation. Thank you so much, Kalila. chapter 1. Chapter 3, verse 1. You're right. It reads like this. So if you're serious about living this new resurrection life with Christ, act like it. Pursue the things over which Christ presides. Don't shuffle along with eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things that are right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. See things from his perspective. Verse 3. Your old life is dead. Your new life, which is your real life, even though invisible to spectators, is with Christ in God. He is your life. Somebody shout hallelujah, glory to God. Somebody say, he is my life. He is my life. Christ died so I can live. Shout hallelujah. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Glory to God. Somebody give God some praise in this place. Oh, give him some praise over here in this place. Man, I just broke it down to you as simple as I can break it down. He died so we can live. Not our life, but live his life. Living his life in this earth realm. The resurrection brought our freedom. The resurrection brought us rest. The resurrection gave us access. The resurrection gave us power. The resurrection gave us the grace of God. The resurrection gave us citizenship. The resurrection gave us dominion. He died so that you can live. Only you will only begin living whenever you begin to live unto Christ and the church saying, amen. 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 Glory to God. Those of you who are in here this morning, if this, you haven't been to church in a minute, thank you so much. If you have not been to church in a while, I want you to know that we sincerely thank you for coming to share this morning with us. We do not take it lightly that you are here. We can't take under consideration that everybody in here is a born-again believer, because that's where it begins. That's where my life started. Because I accepted Jesus in my heart as my Lord and personal Savior. I want you to know that that can start for you as well. Every since that we became born again, our life has gotten better, 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 and better. That's what the Word of God and that's what the relationship is always intended to do. Are you listening to me? So if that is you in here this morning and you have not accepted Jesus in your heart as your Lord and personal Savior, I want you to make that decision this morning. I want you to go ahead and come up front right now so that we can walk you through that prayer of receiving him as your Lord and your personal Savior. He is the undisputed champion of this world. Hallelujah. Did y'all hear that? He has never been defeated, and guess what? He will never, ever be defeated. Amen. If you would like to rededicate yourself and recommit your relationship with him, I think this is a good morning to do that. Matter of fact, if everybody could just join me in just raising up your hands so that you can make that commitment this morning. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I understand what the resurrection meant to me. And from this day forward, I will spend time in your word, time in your presence, and time in fellowship with you, unbroken fellowship. And I declare that this life that I live, I will now live unto you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.